all the muscles in my stomach, they just go into a kind of spasm. And then she shows like this. They just go into a kind of spasm. I said, okay, tell a little bit more. And she says, it is about this stress. Actually, I have not asked her any questions at all. I just said, tell a little bit more. And then she says, my stress has to do with constant fights with my husband, which makes me angry and irritable. And at that point, she starts telling a story. She talks very, very rapidly, almost breathless. Talk, and then this happened, and then that happened, and then my husband did this, and then he did this, and then we went there, and then we had to set the house, and then he said, why don't you go there, and I said, I went there, and I said, I'll buy this, he said, don't buy this, and then I got sick, and then he did this, and then I got angry, and then I got in this, quick. So there was a huge story of the situation in which she was getting angry about it. So I said, in all this situation, what do you feel? And she says, I feel that my husband is purposely trying to hurt me and to get back at me. And at the moment she said, purposely trying to hurt me, she takes her hand and she does like this. He's purposely trying to hurt me. Almost the same movement that she did when she showed the spasm in her stomach. And then she says, in this situation, I feel trapped. So this is her delusion. I say, now do one thing. Let's put everything aside and let's focus on this word trapped, because that is what you perceive. Let's see how the trapped feels. And this is a very important question, because it moves the person into a different level. And here you have really to be with me. It moves the person into a level of his experience. How does trapped feel? How is it inside for you, the experience to be trapped? Are you with me? Now this, hold on. Because this is the crucial point. Up to this point, everybody is very happy to talk. My husband did this, I did this, my mother-in-law, she's such a bad woman, I want to kill her. This is very easy to say, no problem. People are very loquacious when it comes to their emotions or when it comes to their situation. But you say, I don't want to know now anymore about your emotion or your situation. I want to know what is your experience in that situation. I told you, no, I was angry, I was irritated, no. I told you I feel trapped, I want to get out, no. I want to know the experience to be trapped. How does it feel inside? Now something very interesting happens. Many patients don't go beyond this point. They don't want to also, because they never have been there. But if you persist and you have the patience and you repeat this question, then a shift happens, a big shift happens. And the shift that happens is that the mind switches off. Because at that point, you are not asking anything that can come from thought. Are you with me? You are asking something that comes from direct experience, just like the proving in homeopathy. In a proving, when you do proving of bryonia, you are not asking the prover, tell me, what do you think of bryonia? You are asking, tell me, what is it that you experience, isn't it? He tells you the experience of Bryonia. I get stitching, and that stitching goes from here to there, and slightest movement, no thought. Similarly, if we want to find the remedy for the patient, we have to take him to the level where there is no thought. So I told her, let's just do one thing. Let you just focus on the word trapped and see what comes up. And she said, no talking, just focusing. Watch. What is the experience to be trapped? How is it? And at that point, what she does is she automatically closes her eyes. Because now she is looking inside, not outside, not into her mind, but into her experience. And then she watches. And then she says the following words. She says, I feel it is sticky, dirty, slimy, messy. I feel it is claustrophobia. I feel I am attracted. I said, just stay with it. Now, this is the seventh level. The seventh level is the level from which she is able to watch. She is able to look. She is able to be in a blank space. It's almost the level of meditation, isn't it? What do you do in meditation? You just watch. You just look. So, from the seventh level of watching, she is able to look at her experience, and there she saw, she says, I feel as if I am stuck there and the bars all come around me and they close in on me. I said, just stay with it. And she says, this thing doesn't have a door. It doesn't open or shut. It is just one piece, and then I get attracted, I am stuck. And then the whole thing forms itself around me and I can't get out. This is the strangest and the most peculiar thing she can ever see. Are you with me? What is she talking about? Neither does she know, nor at that point I know. So, what is it about? The sensation method is about tapping into the experience, because we believe that experience is the truth. That the experience is the most peculiar thing that a person has, the most individualistic. Hahnemann in Aphorism emphasized the value of peculiar symptom. What is a peculiar symptom? A peculiar symptom is not your emotion. You get angry, it's not peculiar. You feel trapped, it's not peculiar. But your inner experience, your sensation, that's what we call a sensation. Your innermost experience, that is peculiar, that is strange, unexplainable, illogical, but it's completely true. And it is the one has ruled your entire life, and everything else is an expression of that. Then she shows the energy. She says, I should describe this little bit more. She says, I didn't realize that the trap is falling on me. Once I was completely trapped, I saw that it's forming and I can't get out. I'm already in this trap. It's just like this. It's not letting me out. So at that deep level, in some cases, not in all cases, in some cases, they are actually able to go into the depth of their experience, and in that experience, they are able to visualize the source of the remedy that they need. So at that level, she is actually telling us what is the source of her remedy. That observing, that is the seventh level. So, this is her remedy. You can see. You see, this is a plant which has got little dew drops on it. Just give it a thought. How it is possible that somebody can give this picture? The remedy was which one? Drosera. It's called sundew. And that's exactly what it does. and she described this exactly. So we realize that at the core of each person, beyond the symptoms are an expression, her trapped feeling, her claustrophobia, her anger, her irritability, her restlessness, her speed. They are all an indication of the source, the essence of something else that is within her. It may be Drosera, it could be Netram Moor, it could be Ferrum Metallicum, it could be Lachesis, it could be anything. And our case taking, if it proceeds deep enough to the experience, the qualities of this source will come out. You will see which kingdom, which sub-kingdom, and sometimes in a rare case, even the exact source itself. And then you can have absolutely no doubt the remedy that you have to give, because the patient is almost telling you what she needs. And it's not a random collection of symptoms. It is the exact pattern of something in nature that is within a human being. That is sensation. That is source. So, her family was carnivorous plant that traps. The remedy, Drosera rotundifolia, which is the tubercular miasm in this family. A beautiful result. Her thyroid functions improved without any medication, allopathic. Her urticaria went away within a few weeks. And what is most important, her entire anger, her entire trapped feeling went away completely. It's a beautiful change, not only in her thyroid or in her urticaria, but in her entire being. So when you touch that deep core, things change at all levels, at fact level, emotion level, delusion level, sensation level, energy level. At all levels, things change. Hahnemann, in his preface to the Materia Medica Pura, he wrote, as the organism in its normal condition depends only on the state of the vitality, it follows that the changed condition we call disease or sickness must likewise depend not on the operation of physical or chemical principles, but on originally vital sensations and actions. That is to say, dynamically changed state of man, a changed existence through which eventually the parts of the body become altered in character. Do you understand? That first what changes is a whole change in the way you exist. That changes your vital sensations and functions, and this will then change the different organs and systems. So if you touch that, in which way has your existence been changed as reflected in your vital sensation, then you touch the whole being. And mind you, Hahnemann had absolutely no access to any of my books. He has originally written all this, vital sensation. Can you imagine? So he always talks, if you read in the Organon, and now we understand it better, he talks always of change, sensation and function, isn't it? Everywhere, disease means change, sensation and function. That is the sensation he's talking about, the experience, the changed existence. Let's study the utility of this approach. Applying the concept of miasms. Here is a 63-year-old man with cervical spondylosis. His main symptom was stiffness in the neck. He cannot move the neck. He is a teacher of meditation. He is a great philosopher. He has read a lot of books and he spoke extensively about this philosophy. But when I asked him, what is your main complaint? He said, it is stiffness of the neck. And I said, describe stiffness. He said, I cannot move it. It's just stuck. And I have to live with this. There's no other way I can live. And I said, tell me, you believe a lot in meditation, you meditate 6 hours a day. What is the advantage for you? And he says, in meditation, I feel free. I said, what is free? He says, I feel as if I am not caught or stuck. So meditation was essentially for him a kind of way out of this caught, stiff, stuck feeling. Like you're caught in the traffic, like you're in a traffic jam, that there is no freedom. And the pains are better by movement. So the sensation was caught, stuck, bound, cannot move, and better by movement. It reminds you a lot of Rustox. And the family is Anacardiaceae. But his remedy was not Rustox, because the pace at which he felt this was not the Rustox pace. What is the Rustox pace? You are going somewhere, you lift a bucket, it's sudden. And then it's intense for some time. And then after some time, you do this, you do this, you do this, you do some action, and then you're free. So it's like a crisis period, intense, short. And this we call as the pace is like a typhoid disease. It comes suddenly, intensely, it lasts for some time, and then it goes away almost without a trace. This is the pace of Rustox. So this was not the pace. So Rustox would not have helped him. What is the pace? In his case, the family sensation is good, stiffness and stuck and better by movement. But the pace is, it is steady, it is fixed. And which miasm has this fixed kind of pace? Usually psychotic, no? Like a wart, it stays on you, it's just stuck. Nothing happens, nothing changes, nothing moves. It doesn't kill you, but it doesn't go. So we had to understand that we needed a remedy from the same family, but a different pace and depth, which is of psychotic miasm. Next. And for this, we have the classification of miasms, which is acute, which is a sudden pace. Sora, which is the problem, is solvable and hopeful. Psychotic is fixed. Syphilitic is destructive. The question is this enough? Are we happy with this four? Can the entire world be fitted into hopeful, destructive, or fixed? Can there be some other kind of pace? What about a guy who says, my pace is as follows, that for days nothing happens and suddenly I get an attack, and then I'm okay for a few days, suddenly I get an attack. Have you heard this or no? Have you heard this in migraine cases? Have you heard this in asthma cases? Have you heard this in sciatica cases? So what about this? What is this pace? Where shall we put it? Come on, you tell me. You cannot put it in this four. So then we had to create new kinds of miasms. In this was intermittent attacks like malaria. The critical period. Somebody said, oh God, I lost so much money in the stock market. Now what shall I do? I have to take out money from there, put it there, take money from here, put it there, do this, do that, and somehow get over this crisis. And once I'm through the crisis, I can take rest. It's like bryonia. So that is typhoid, the pace of typhoid disease. Malaria has the intermittent pace. So I found out that just like syphilis has a destructive pace, that psychosis has a fixed pace. In natural gonorrhea, for example, malaria has an intermittent phase, typhoid has a critical phase, ringworm alternates between fixed and hopeful. That means sometimes you feel it can be solved, sometimes you feel, no, I have to live with it. Cancer, you feel chaotic, you cannot put things in control. Tubercular is a hectic pace. That means quicker, 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 do. And leprosy has a pace where you are disgusted and isolated. So there are also other classifications, and these are the 10 totally that I found can make a map of the different types of pace and depth of a given state. And this is very helpful in practice. Applying this theory, what we did is, by very careful study, we classified the different plants of a given family into the different miasms. And now if we look at Anacardiaceae, and then we look at psychotic miasm, you get the remedy mangi, which is Mangifera indica, which is our mango. And that's the remedy this patient received, Mangifera indica, and he did beautifully, beautifully well. So Roostox would not have helped him, Anacardium would not have helped him, but Mangifera helped him. If you look at a rubric in the repertory, you find in Mangifera, spondylitis cervical, you have three remedies, carcinosin, Mangifera and phosphoric acid. And see how beautifully now your understanding of family and miasm comes together with the rubric. It's so beautiful because cervical spondylosis is exactly fixed stiffness of the neck. Fixed stiffness means psychotic miasm, Anacardiaceae family, they come together. So many, many times you will find that your kingdom approach and rubrics, they speak exactly the same language. And then you are so sure of the remedy. Another case, 40-year-old woman with autoimmune hepatitis. Here she has a dream that there is someone. I asked her first, how do you feel with the hepatitis? She says, it's as if I'm locked in a prison. So describe this. And she says, I have a dream as if somebody has made me into a golden statue. What is the experience of it? It's as if I'm stiff and I cannot move. And the main feeling was, first of all, I'm stuck and I cannot come out, which is psychotic. But also, as if I'm unfortunate, as if I keep getting harassed by people, everybody troubles me from time to time. And so her miasm was actually malarial. So we have Anacardiaceae, malaria miasm, and we gave her remedy, not Roostox, not Mangifera, not Anacardium, but Rous radicans. And then we saw she immediately improved. You see her total bilirubin over the next 1 year went from 9.6 to 0.5 and SGPT from 880 to 21. And she was in line for a liver transplant actually because she was really in a bad shape. And within a couple of months, she started improving and within a year, she was completely normal with Rous radicans. These are just to show you how we use the miasms and why it is important, this classification. Now, another utility of this approach is to use lesser known remedies. I will give you some examples. Here is a man with 67-year-old male. He developed a heart attack and some heart problems. So he went in for bypass. And when he came out of the bypass, after a few days, he started developing renal problems and he went into chronic renal failure. His serum creatinine jumped up. It went to some 8 or 9 or something like that. And he developed all symptoms of renal failure. So he was also in line for dialysis and ultimately transplant. When I asked him his history, he said that he owns a machine factory in South India and he is the owner and the proprietor of that factory. And what he does is that people come to him with problems. They say, we want to make a machine like that for this particular purpose. This machine has never been made before. It has to suit a particular job. And so he has to put his entire mind into how to create that. And then he has a timeline, you know, within 3 months you have to do it or 2 months or 1 month. And he says, I love this job. I don't sleep night and I don't sleep days. I just put my mind and I work 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 and I persist, use every bit of my creative resource and somehow I tackle the job because there is no guide for me. Nobody knows this. Only I have to do it. I can't even ask anyone because it's never been made before. So he says there's a lot of pressure. So his main theme was perseverance in creating something new. Now, just think. What will you do with this with traditional homeopathy? Where will you look? Do you know any remedy that has this idea? Yes or no? Huh? Do you know any rubric that could indicate this symptom? This is his main symptom. What will you do? Here is where this kingdom approach has an advantage, because now we know that even if we don't know any remedy exactly with this symptom or rubric, we know that a particular row of the periodic table has this theme. Which row is it? So this is a fifth row theme, and he lies somewhere in the middle. Let's see the periodic table. He lies somewhere in the middle, and he lies actually in the eighth column, because the eighth column has ferrum, and the theme of ferrum is very, very strong persistence, obstinate. If you know ferrum metallicum as a remedy in Materia Medica, very positive, very persistent. But his remedy is not ferrum, but ruthenium, because it's in row 5. And that's the remedy he received, ruthenium. Ferrum is in row 4, ruthenium is in row 5. So just below ferrum, he got remedy ruthenium. And what happened with ruthenium? He improved, and over a period of time, his serum creatinine dropped from 4.9 gradually down to 1.8. And his hemoglobin from 7.8 reached up to 12.6. And what is most interesting, of course, his symptoms got better, his energy got better, his moods got better. But what did he do? What do you think? He was 67 years old. By the time we finished his treatment, he was 68, 69. He gave up his machine factory and decided to tell stories to his grandchildren, because he didn't feel the compulsion to have to stay in that pressurizing job of creating anymore. Are you with me? This is how it changes your whole perception of life and your compulsions. We talk of a 26-year-old male with numular eczema. He had very severe eczema on his leg, right or left, I forgot. And very chronic. He had been to a couple of homeopaths before, taken treatment for like 6 or 8 years. Nothing happened. He was referred to me. He came. I asked him the first question, what is it that you experience with this eczema? And he said, I feel handicapped. What do you mean by handicapped? He said, as if I have no leg. You know which remedy has this? Baraita Kaab. But his remedy was not Baraita Kaab, but it was from the same row of the periodic table. I said, describe this. He says, I feel handicapped. I lack the ability to stand on my feet and take responsibility and leadership. I said, tell me more. And he says, I have the question, can I do it or can I not do it? Should I or should I not? Do I have or don't I have? Now, the thing with Baraita is, he feels I don't have. There's no question. There are no questions. But here he had a question. Can I or can I not? Can I or can I not? Should I need to be conservative? Should I just keep doing the same thing? Or should I go out and strike out on my own and make my own leadership? Or should I just stay by the rule book and do exactly what others tell me? So should I be like this or should I step out? My whole life is this alternation. What to do with this? Again, here we have a problem with traditional Materia Medica, that unless the symptom is exactly defined, we don't know what to do, isn't it? But with the kingdom approach, we are able to now say, this is the theme of the sixth row, but it's not Baraita, it's a little bit later than that. Alternating between conquering the world and taking responsibility, or lacking in confidence. And his remedy was not Baraita, was not lanthanum, not hafnium, but he got tantalum. Tantalum is that stage, should I stay or should I get out? Should I stay or should I get out? So that was his remedy. He did very beautifully. We have a little photograph here for you. That was the eczema, and he did very well on that. And he's okay now, so many years have passed. We talk of a 20-year-old girl with polycystic ovarian disease. Now, she had come to me a long time ago, and I had given her remedies like Calcarea Carb and Telia Europaea, things like that, but they didn't work. And she had a cyst that was like 9 centimeters in diameter. It was huge. It was extremely painful. The gynecologist had said, you are crazy if you are going to continue with this cyst. It needs immediate surgery. It could even burst any time. So she came into my office one day with such severe pains. It's unbelievable. She was, I think, having dysmenorrhea or something. It was excruciating. She was lying and screaming and screaming and screaming with the pain. So much so, I had to even take her to the casualty of a hospital to see if there something was terribly wrong. I really had to sit with her and understand her innermost experience. And her experience was, there was a dream in which she was inside a house, and that somebody from outside was coming, breaking and smashing into the house and pulling her out and finishing her. Then I understood it's probably an animal remedy. Then she said, it's like to be locked in a golden cage, under protection, under shield. And inside this cage lies some creature which has no form. And something will come, just grab, pull, take it out. And she gave these images. And she said, things come and fill me. There's an inlet, and there's no filter there, and then they come in, and then they are flushed out, and then they open and they shut. And this was all completely bonkers for me. I couldn't understand one word that she was saying. She says, it's as if I have no figure, as if there is something whitish, as if there is some cobwebs all around me. So many times when patients go into the depth of their experience, they mention all these things which are from the source, and you have absolutely no clue what they are talking about. And this is where also the kingdom theory helps, because you are now don't depend on this, but first you see what's the kingdom, oh it's animal, then you say what is a sub-kingdom. In this case, I understood that the sub-kingdom was a mollusk. A mollusk is like a shell, you know, that opens and shuts, that is a protective barrier that can get smashed and pulled out. Now I had to find which exact mollusk she needed. And the remedy she needed was the clam. It is called Venus Mercenaria. And we know, after studying from the internet, now we have even written a book on mollusk, which is really worth for you to go through. So in this research of the mollusk book, we found that she was almost exactly giving us the description of the clam, of water inlet that comes in and that gets flushed out, that things that open and things that shut, and even that cobweb that is around her, all is a description of the mollusk. Once she got the remedy, the result was dramatic. And she, her size of the cyst decreased from 8.5 and gradually 6.2, 4.7, 2.9, almost hardly there now. And the pain disappeared. Her whole life changed. So we are able to expand our materia medica. Here we are talking about a 41-year-old male patient with central serous retinopathy. And he talks about a stress situation where he is threatened by the mafia, by the Bhai log. And he says, for me, I am somebody who will not bow down to this kind of threat. I will stand up to them and I will fight to the finish. And he says, I feel like a man that's fighting a very stormy big sea, but I will not give up till the very end. Either he finished or I'm finished. That's it. He says, when I'm attacked, I am single focused. I don't see anything around. And he mentioned one example where he just caught a man and just smashed him like that, like this. He took him and then just smashed him. He showed this action like this. Smash. And then I said, what do you like to do? And then he gave a smile and he says, I like to watch the National Geographic Planet, and especially about the big cats and about the lion. And I like that when the lion chases the victim, he's a poor victim. But when he said, there was a smile, you know, that extended cheek to cheek, poor victim. But he said, that's the law of nature, isn't it? And then the lion chases. I said, tell me more. And he says, the lion chases, its attention is only on that creature, and then it smashes it like this. This is the same action that he did when he hit somebody. And he got the remedy lacleoninum, and his retinopathy disappeared. But what is interesting, of course, is lacleoninum wasn't a remedy in our Materia Medica before. I got it from a veterinary doctor who was treating lions, and I requested him to somehow obtain me a little bit of milk of the lion. And he did. It was a very lucky thing for us that he was there and he obtained milk, and I potentized it in my clinic. What was interesting is that when we did a proving of this, and there was a woman prover who was really pulsatilla before, very mild, very gentle, I know her socially, very yielding, very soft. And we gave her the proving, and then she came, got video like this. I said, what was it? She said, that maid servant in my house, I told my husband, either she stays or I stay. And let anybody come in my way, I just want to smash them. Just like this. She didn't know what she was taking. I asked her, what are you taking? Do you know what you are proving? She said, I know I'm proving a big cat. I think it's a tiger. So she was very close, because tiger and lions are biologically very, very close. So proving brings out the same spirit. The patient brings out the same spirit. At that level, when the comparison happens, along with the symptoms, your predictability increases many fold. Not only we can know new remedies, but we can understand well-known remedies much, much deeper through this approach. Let's take a case. Here is a case of a 32-year-old female with rheumatoid arthritis. RA factor is positive. She has crippling joint pains and swellings in many, many joints of her body. I ask her, what is the issue? What's going on in her life? And she says, I feel because of these joints, I'm dependent and disabled. She said, there are good people and bad people. And then there are people who are lying and cheating and hypocritical. And then there's people who make you feel inferior, but I am very, very loyal. So these are the words that she used to describe her perception of life and the situation, that she needs a group, but in that group, there are people who are making her feel inferior. I'm actually cutting the long story very, very short. This is a 2.5-hour interview in which it's so beautiful the way she brings out her perception of life. Was so similar to the survival of a dog, and she got lacanium as a remedy. So we understand lacanium much better through that understanding, and not only through the rubrics. And she did very well. Her arthritis almost completely disappeared, and her RA factor became from positive to negative. We have a long follow-up now, more than 5 years. A 30-year-old male with cardiomyopathy. Again, in line for heart transplant, because cardiomyopathy is a disease of the heart muscle which doesn't really have treatment. And his story was that he has a very strong sense of right and wrong. And what is wrong for him is when four or five people attack one person. This is terribly wrong. It's very unjust. And then he will get down from a moving bus or a car or a taxi, and he will go and defend the person who is being attacked. And he says, I will not strike unless I am provoked, and then I will warn, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. And if they still persist, then I will strike. And when I strike, I don't care what happens. I will kill. This is it. This was a story. And this is a very strong reptilian quality. The quality of comparison is animal. The quality of I am weak and I am being attacked by so many people and I am alone. Very reptile quality, this great inequality. And that I will strike back is a typical quality in the snakes of a particular group called Elapidae. This is what we are studying, and how we are studying it. And in the Elapidae comes our favorite snake, the cobra, which rears its head and says, don't come forward, I will finish you. That's the remedy he got, Naja. And he did beautifully. Left ventricular ejection fraction, which was 27%, kept increasing. It was 63%, which is normal. And his follow-ups are very interesting, because when I go for a walk in the beach in the morning, I am walking slowly and the guy is jogging in front of me and saying, I am fine, doctor, you know, this is crazy, I should be jogging. He should be in the hospital actually. So he is doing very well with Naja. Combining the old and the new. We talk about a 22-year-old girl with idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. And she had already had a splenectomy done because condition was not coming under control. And it had dropped down to some 15,000 or something like that when she came, the platelet count. And her main story was that she was a young girl. She was like in her 20s, 25 or 26. And her main issue was, what if somebody finds out about my splenectomy? Then I will not get married. Society will outcast me. And this was the constant anxiety that she lived. The constant anticipation, the fixed idea that she would be outcasted, rejected, thrown out, forced out. And this, she was living in this constant anticipation. And therefore, she would always hide from other people this fact. Also, she had a very complex about that she was dark-skinned. And also, she tried to cover up this dark skin by using a lot of cosmetics, but it didn't work, and she would try to hide it somehow from other people. So there was a very fixed idea that she was not okay, that something was wrong with her body, and this would cause her to be forced out from society. Are you with me? That was her state. And she had a pain in the head, as if something will be burst out and will come out. So the family here is Liliaceae. Liliaceae, if you see the remedy Materia Medica Lilium Tigrinum, the main sensation is forced out, pushed out as the sensation. The main idea of this is that in Bonninghausen, he propounded the idea that any sensation is general and not local. This is called grand generalization. I have used this idea a lot. That's the basis of all the work. So if Lilium Tigrinum has forced out sensation in the pelvis, it has also forced out sensation in the head, then he must also have mentally the experience of being forced out. Are you with me? Because the mind and the body are not really two separate entities in homeopathy. So I understood that the Liliaceae sensation is forced out, because the sensation of one plant in the family is the sensation usually of the whole family, like the injury of Arnica or the terror of Solanaci. So here the anticipation was, I will be thrown out. So Liliaceae family, and the fixed idea was psychotic miasm, and therefore the remedy was Sabadilla or Crocus or Helonias or Lilium tigrinum. In my chart, I have given all the four remedies. This is confusing. So what to do? Here we went into the repertory and we found in Sabadilla, the rubrics of the mind, delusion, erroneous ideas about his body parts, that some part is deformed, that he is smaller. He has got fixed ideas. So because of her fixed ideas about her body, I gave her Sabadilla. And she had also some desires of Sabadilla, like raw onions. Now it's very interesting. What can you tell me about raw onions? Also, which family? Onion is Liliaceae. So you see, desires and aversions also are part of the pattern. If Natramur craves for salt and sulfur dislikes or likes bad smells, it's part of the story, isn't it? And the bursting headache also was in Sabadilla. And also she had sneezing symptoms of Sabadilla. So here we used the repertory in association with the idea of the kingdoms and got to Sabadilla. And her platelet count did very well. And more important than her platelet count doing well, she did very well. She lost all her extra consciousness about her skin color. She went out into the world. She found a person to marry. She married. She told him straight away, you see, I have a problem. My spleen is gone. I have ITP. There was no problem with him. She is now happily settled, doing her profession, and all is well. So her whole attitude of mind perception changed. So to conclude, a sensation approach is not a replacement, but an addition, a complement to classical homeopathy. It's very much a part of classical homeopathy. It is a way in which we can deepen and widen our understanding of both patients and remedies. And by using a system of kingdoms, miasms, and levels, we are able to find a map by which we can approach both patients and remedies, and used in conjunction with repertory, materia medica, and traditional sources of homeopathy, it becomes a very, very useful tool in our practice and actually really changes our perception of what disease is, what health is, what cure is. And that is what we want to achieve with this method. And that's what we are doing. And I thought it was a good time to introduce newcomers to this method. The basic idea is that, like any technique system, it has to be learned systematically. For that, I suggest 3-4 things. Number one is the books. So I've written a series of books. If you want a shortcut to it, read The Sensation in Homeopathy, read The Sensation Refined after that, and if you want an overview of the whole thing, read the book The Other Song. These three are books on the concept and the case-taking techniques, and Sensation Refined is specifically about difficulties in case-taking. Sensation is about the technique of case-taking, Sensation Refined is about the difficulties. And Other Song is about the concept. And in Sensation Refined is also the question, what's the difference between a sensation and a miasm? That's one way to go about it. Secondly, books on information, we wrote structure about all the lesser known remedies. You can find the kingdom, sub-kingdom quality, so you can confirm. We have written on plants, 3 volumes, minerals, 2 volumes, and now animals, there will be at least 13 volumes. One is already out. So you have information also. This is all as far as the books are concerned. But I would suggest, in order to learn more, we will be organizing a series of courses. There'll be a basic course followed by an advanced course. It would be really worth your while to join these courses, because here you will get practical training, questions, answers, discussions, and you can learn it systematically. You can't learn it in a lecture, and you can't fully learn it from the books. So I hope that this little talk and the discussion we have whets your appetite to go further into it and to see that yes, there is some value here and I want to learn. Really, it's worth your while to learn it and to see it in practice.